We all make our choices. And those choices, they put us on a road. Sometimes those choices seem small, but they put you on the road. You think about getting off, but eventually you're back on it.
Welcome to the Dreams of Consciousness podcast. If you'd be so kind, would you mind introducing yourself?
Thank you. My name's Paul. I'm the lead guitar player and vocalist in Denouncement Pyre from Australia.
And Paul, how would you describe the music of Denouncement Pyre?
I guess we've always referred to it as being black death metal, taking influence from 80s and 90s black and death metal, and then sort of producing a sound that's an amalgamation of both those genres, mainly focused around underground mentality and sound. Whether you want to call it more black or more death is not overly important to us. I guess we just call it black death because it's the easiest way to summarize our sound.
Now, Australia has a number of notable black death, war metal bands. Would you say that there's a sound that Australia is known for, and that Denouncement Pyre has aspects of that sound?
I think to a degree, for sure. I think going back to some of the bands that were based in particularly Melbourne in the early to mid-90s, bands like Bestial Warlust and Destroyer 666, Gospel of the Horns to lesser a degree, perhaps Vomitor as well in the late 90s, had that really raw, you know, black death thrash sound that became known as war metal, I guess, in the underground overseas. Though there weren't many bands that actually used that tag themselves, it's sort of synonymous with the Australian sound. And I think for Denouncement Pyre, especially early on, we certainly had stronger aspects of that than what we do now. But it's sort of inevitable. I mean, we all listen to those bands still and love those bands and have been fortunate to play with many of those old bands. So there's no doubt that it rubs off in our sound a little bit as well.
And I should mention that you also play in Nocturnal Graves, who were on the podcast earlier in the year.
Yeah, that's right. I play guitar in Nocturnal Graves as well and have done so since 2009.
So as far as Denouncement Pyre goes, can you tell me a little bit about how you formed the band and what your intentions were at the time?
So we started the band when we were quite young. It was around the end of 2002, early 2003. Myself being a founding member with another friend of mine who's no longer in the band. He left before we recorded any of the albums. So we really just wanted to make the kind of music that we listened to as well, which was, you know, really nasty, savage sounding black death metal with a wide range of influences. And we didn't really have any end goals. I never really thought about whether we would record an album or anything like that. We started probably like most bands with a demo tape and playing a few shows locally, and that sort of grew over time to become something more. So next year is the 20th year that I've been doing the band, and we haven't really stopped since that initiation, I guess. But the band sort of grew to take on a lot more meaning in my life, and the new album we've just released last week, Forever Burning, is the fourth album that we've done, and I never really planned or envisaged that I'd still be doing the band after nearly 20 years, but here we are.
And we can talk about the legacy of the band and what it means to you, kept it going for this long. I am curious, in those early years when it was just you and another member, did you think of it as like a project or a hobby, or did you have aspirations for it to grow bigger than what it was at the time?
I think we always took it seriously. It's kind of funny when you talk about music and whether it's a hobby or not. Most people would determine a hobby by something that you do just for fun. So in that regard, I wouldn't have called it a hobby because we took it quite serious when we were writing songs and you know, playing our instruments. It started off with myself and our original member, Jimmy, who we were both guitar players. So we ended up getting together with Chris Volcano, who at the time was quite active in the scene, mainly as the drummer for Abominator, but had played in a bunch of other Australian death and black metal bands. And even though, you know, when you're starting out, you make no money and it costs you a lot to do and it takes a lot of time, I'd say that we took it serious from the start. It was never a hobby, but I never plan too far ahead with the band, and I still don't. I sort of do one thing at a time, whether it's some shows that we've got pending or writing or recording. So that's always been the way. I don't look forward more than, say, a year at a time. So I leave it open that I don't know where we're going to go and where it's going to end up. But yeah, we certainly didn't do it just for fun. We tried to get better at our songwriting our instruments, and we took it quite serious from day one.
Do you remember what the reaction was to your early recordings and some of your early gigs?
Yeah, when we released our first demo, it was in, the band started early 2003 and we recorded in April 2004, which was a three-track demo. And the reaction to it was quite positive, especially locally. I think at that period, the local scene was in a position where a lot of the older bands that flew the flag for that Black Death thrash Aussie type sound had somewhat moved on. Destroyer had moved overseas. There were some other bands that were not playing regularly. It was, I guess, a bit of a dip in the scene at the time, with some other new and emerging bands coming out, but not particularly in the style that we were playing. So there was a lot of feedback at the time that it was a somewhat of a breath of fresh air to hear a band that was still going to, I guess, pursue that savage kind of unrelenting sound, where there was other bands around locally that were doing stuff that wasn't as extreme as what we were doing then. So the feedback was quite good. We managed to get in contact with a bunch of bands and zines and labels overseas. And at that time in the early 2000s, it was still possible to write to zines and do, you know, interviews by mail. And it was still cheap enough to send out, you know, CDs and tapes via post, not like today where it's all digital and it's just a nightmare in terms of postage costs. So we sort of came around at the back end of that period, just prior to the internet taking over. So I think it kind of shaped the way we looked at things, because we certainly saw ourselves as an underground band. And as the years moved on more towards the sort of 2005, 2010 period, that's when I think the internet took over and things changed. And you felt that locally with the types of bands that were then coming out as new bands, and suddenly before very long feeling like we didn't have much that we could relate to in that sense. You know, we kind of always felt like we just did our own thing and stood out on our own. And even today, I think that's still the case. You know, you look at Melbourne where we're based, and it's quite difficult for us to play shows with similar types of bands because there's simply not a lot around in the style that we're doing.
So when you play, who do you usually play with?
We've got a show in a couple of weeks in Melbourne, and we haven't played in Melbourne since 2019, and it's quite a mixed lineup. There's a band from New Zealand called Stalker, which is an old school heavy metal band. I haven't seen them before. I've only heard a couple of their tracks. And there's some other bands that are, I guess you could say, somewhat punkish, you know, a little bit of death metal, certainly not on the black metal side of things. And we've often found ourselves locally, I guess, as the odd band out on lineups, especially over the last few years. In terms of local bands, there's, you know, Nocturnal Graves as well, but that's quite difficult to play two shows in the one night with both bands. And then in the black death genre, there's a few other new bands and some older bands like Destructor and Cemetery Urn, but it is quite difficult to put a full lineup together with bands that are, I guess, in sync with what we're doing.
Heading into your first album, which came out in 2010, Denouncement Pyre had already put out a number of EPs and splits. Did you feel pretty solid about the sound by the time you headed into that first album? Were you guys like very confident that this was the direction that you wanted to go in?
The time leading up to the first album was really difficult. We had some lineup changes after the first couple of 7-inches and EPs, and we'd gone through a couple of drummers, and the band was pretty much left just to myself at that point. So I would say it was somewhat difficult to get to the stage of recording the first album, even though the process to record it was quite easy. I recruited a drummer, Denny, who has played in a bunch of other Aussie bands. You might have heard of Stargazer and Cauldron Black Ram. There's a couple of the main bands he's been in, and it was just myself and him to record the first album. So he did the drums and then I recorded everything else. I think looking back at that first album, it's very simple and somewhat limited in terms of the experience that I had to try and produce that album almost on my own. I think the arrangements are very simple. in a way that I think things have grown and developed a lot since then. It's honestly not a record I go back and listen to very often. We still play a couple of tracks from it live, but I think that the second album, Almighty Arcanum, is where we sort of found our feet, and that was because we had a solid lineup and I was able to, I guess, have gained some experience from the first album and was a lot more focused in terms of what we wanted to do. So when I think about World Cremation as a first record, for me, it's somewhat immature in the way it's written. It's just, it's very simple is how I hear it.
And once you had a full lineup and a more solid lineup, how did your songwriting process change?
I think it came with time and experience to know, once you had developed your own sort of style with how you play, you know, as a guitarist, the type of riffs you go for, and just being able to then dive deeper into the ideas. So not sort of settling on, I guess, some of the simpler ideas that would come up first, but really pushing beyond that to see how you could layer some of the instruments and take things in a different direction that were new compared to what your usual formulas were. To me, the first album sort of closes the book on the EPs that preceded that. And I think Almighty Arcanum, if you compare that as a second record, it's a lot more layered in terms of the guitars. We introduced a lot of melodies, more guitar solos, you know, multi-tracked vocals, all this sort of thing. So I think by then I'd had more experience and knew how to get to the sound I wanted, and was also just more open to the creative process in terms of pursuing constantly new ways of doing things and breaking the formula with songwriting.
How does a song usually start for you?
Usually just on the guitar. As a guitarist, that it sort of makes the most sense. You'd be jamming away and I'm usually always writing something to varying degrees. You know, I'll have a file there on the computer where I'll just record riffs and over time let them grow into ideas. I don't really worry about sitting down to try to write songs. I just simply come up with ideas that I think sound cool and then just dive right into them to see, you know, what direction you can steer them, you know, how far can you push an idea. That's traditionally how we've written, yeah.
And when you take the beginnings of these songs to the rest of the band, how complete are they in terms of song structure?
A couple of the albums, like Almighty Arcanum and Black Sun Unbound, which was the last record we did prior to the new one, I pretty much wrote full songs that I would then take to the band that we would jam out and just put them through their paces to see if there were parts that we could improve or ideas that weren't going to make the cut, trim a bit of fat off it, that sort of thing. But I was pretty much the only songwriter for those albums. So a lot of the ideas were developed on my own and then taken to the band where we'd, I guess, put the finishing touches on it and make sure that we could, you know, perform it live and have it sound like a band should do, because that's how I want our records to sound. With the new album, the process was quite different this time and a lot more collaborative. We've had a new guitar player join us for the new record, and he managed to write a couple of songs as well as contribute most of the lead guitars. He's certainly a much better guitar player in terms of guitar leads than I am. So the process on the new one was a lot more collaborative. Our drummer as well sat in on a lot of the writing sessions to steer the ideas in terms of what he could bring to the table from a drums perspective. So I think we're going to only pursue that going forward. The process has sort of changed with the new album, that it is a lot more of a band effort, and it seemed to get more out of our sound, I think, with everyone contributing somewhat.
The new guitarist is T?
The new guitarist is Tap, is his name.
How did you meet him and how did he end up joining the band?
He's actually the guy I've known, I guess, for the shortest period of time compared to the other guys in the band. I met him maybe 4 or 5 years ago. We met in Melbourne, I think from memory, at a show, and we just hit it off straight away. It's sort of rare to meet someone that you would connect with almost instantly, and we've been good friends, the lot of us, since. So we had some changes prior to the COVID period where we were struggling with coming up with new ideas and with having some direction in the band. And once Tap joined the band, I think he brought a lot to the table in terms of just being able to offer some new input, some new ideas. For myself, having written, you know, three albums prior to him joining, you do have your formulas and your way of doing things, and it's often somewhat restrictive. I think by three albums, you've certainly developed your sound, but it's also restrictive in a way because you go to the same formulas when it comes to writing. So to have another guitarist in the band now that I could work with and we could both come up with ideas has been really beneficial.
So let's talk about this new album. It's called Forever Burning, and it was released on June 17th through Agonia Records. You mentioned the COVID period and the difficulty in coming up with new material. Did you start writing this during the lockdowns?
There were ideas that made the album that were written pretty soon after Black Sun Unbound. So we're probably talking 2017 or so. But we did predominantly record the album during the lockdown COVID period. We'd sort of planned to do an album around 2020. And then it just kept getting, I guess, harder to get it actually done because of everything that was happening down here. So it wasn't really written during that period. A lot of the ideas had been around for some time before that, but I guess it came to fruition during that period.
So you mentioned that this has been the most collaborative album so far. Did you go into this wanting to do anything different musically?
I think we always do have the mindset that we don't want to create the same record twice. I really like when you look at even classic bands where each album has its own feel, its own sound. You hear the way that a band develops and grows. You look at classic, you know, the first three Metallica records is an obvious one. You know, bands like Iron Maiden, Judas Priest, they've got periods of their discography where they pursue a certain sound, and you hear how some albums are sort of linked and off the back of each other, but they have periods where you can hear that they've tried to do something new. And I really like that approach. I don't really see the point to sit and write the same type of album again. So we went into this one with more of a stripped back approach in terms of what we wanted to do. I thought on the last record that it was about 50 minutes and it started to get a little bit long for my liking. And a lot of the songs were sort of 6 minutes, 6.5 minutes. So I wanted to do something that was a little more direct and in your face. And the end result then was trimming back a lot of the ideas, and it sort of moved things across to more traditional song structures with verses and choruses. And I think that made the music really catchy and memorable, but as a result as well, meant that a lot of the songs were, you know, 4 minutes, 4.5 minutes, not 6 minutes. So it's a shorter album. I think it's very direct and it sort of gets to the point, which is what we I wouldn't say we had a plan just to do that from the start, but that's the idea and concept that grew as we worked on it and the way we decided to go compared to the last album.
Yeah, I mean, even besides the shorter songs, this album does have like more of a classic feeling. You know, I was thinking of like a lot of like classic Priest or maybe even early Bathory, you know, that kind of feeling to some of the songs.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, there's a lot of stuff that's just straight up real, I guess you could say, headbangers. You know, they're traditional structures. We sort of steered clear of playing at tempos that were too quick. I like blast beats and I think they have their place, but on this record, a lot of the tempos we went for were a lot slower. So even when it's blasting, it's not, you know, it's not hyper or anything. It's more at a tempo that you could bang your head to. So that became a conscious thing as well. I think it's just a lot more old school and traditional in that sense.
Yeah, it does feel like a very like headbangable album, or almost like a festival album. Do you know what I mean?
Absolutely. Yeah, I agree.
Can you tell me a little bit about how you ended up recording this album?
In terms of like the recording process?
Yeah.
Yeah, sure. So we took a different approach to how we've done all of the other albums. Previously, we would go into the studio and do it all in one location. So we would start with drums, we'd lay those down, then we'd lay down guitars, bass, vocals, and then mix it in the studio there. And we've recorded previously with Jerome from Nocturnal Graves. He's got his own studio. So the last couple of records were done following that process, but this time we recorded or tracked across three different locations. So we recorded the drums in one studio. I managed to record guitars and vocals in my own home studio, and then we mixed it with Jerome in his studio. So it was somewhat of a learning experience to do it that way. We had the benefit of, for example, recording the vocals in my own studio, which meant I could really set the atmosphere the way I wanted it, and, you know, wasn't rushed to like when you're paying for a studio and you go in and you've got a couple of days to record vocals and you have to get it done then and there, I was able to do it at a pace where I could get the most out of it in terms of the performance and feeling really relaxed and focused and just really good energy during those sessions, which you can't always replicate on the spot if you're in a studio somewhere else. So I think we sort of learned a lot from that process. It was difficult because we were in lockdown for some of that time. I'm not sure how much you know about Melbourne in particular in Australia, but we had some of the harshest lockdown laws in the world at that period. So, for example, when we wanted to mix the album, the studio where we were mixing is a couple of hours drive away from where we live, and we were supposed to not leave the house or even see each other at that time. You know, we were pretty much locked in our homes. So we had to break the rules a bit to get it done, which I think that attitude was reflected in some of the playing on the album, because it was a time when we were certainly pissed off a lot because of the way we were living at that time.
So to clarify, when you guys were recording in different locations, was that a result of the social distancing requirements, or was it something that you guys had planned on doing prior to that?
It was something we planned to do with this album. I guess I wanted the luxury of being able to track vocals and guitars in my own studio, where I was not bound by time restraints in particular. And the studio where we recorded the drums was mainly chosen because of the location. It was in Melbourne, and we were able to book in the time that we wanted to get it done. So that was something we'd planned. I guess the lockdown pressures were just added on top of that and made the whole thing a lot more challenging.
So as you mentioned, Juro from Nocturnal Graves mixed the album, and you've had a long working relationship with Juro since you also play Nocturnal Graves. Is your working relationship with him and the amount of time that you've known him, does that make having him master or having him mix the album a comfortable experience for you?
Yeah, I've known Juro for 20 odd years, and obviously we played in bands and traveled overseas and toured together, and you know, we spent a lot of time together, and we've always had the luxury, I guess, of mixing with him, where he understands the technical stuff in terms of what we're trying to produce, and then also understands in terms of the sound what we're going for, because you know, he's listened to this sort of music for 30 years and he's an underground head like the rest of us. So I have at other times had recordings where we've worked with engineers and things that haven't been into extreme metal, and that certainly presents some challenges in terms of getting them to understand what we're trying to do. But we've got the luxury of him certainly having an absolute understanding of what sound we're going for and you know, what the band's about.
Can you tell me who you sent the album to get mastered, or who mastered the album?
Yeah, the album was mastered in Melbourne here by a friend of ours as well, who actually is the guy that I started Denouncement Pyre with nearly 20 years ago. So he has a business where he produces audio equipment, so studio mastering compressors and things like this, as well as the ability to mix, record and master music. So again, we went with him, someone who's familiar with our sound and the style. So yeah, it was mastered here in Melbourne.
And his name is James, right?
Yes, correct.
What would you say he brought to the sound in terms of mastering?
The goal with the mastering was not to change the sound. We really focus on using the mix to get the sound that we want. The goal of mastering was simply to push the sound to its full capacity without it being overly compressed. And we went through a few masters back and forward. I'm not really into the modern sound that's overly compressed and, you know, bands that try and have everything as loud as it can possibly be. I understand the appeal of that in terms of a first impression, but it's not the sound we go for. So there was plenty of discussions about trying to keep it, you know, as organic as we could. In particular, I think the vinyl master sounds really, really strong.
So as we mentioned, Denouncement Pyre has been around for almost 20 years now, and you just released your fourth album. Having not expected for it to go this long or accomplish what you've accomplished at this point, is there anything left that you still want to do?
It's an interesting question. I guess my first thought is that, you know, I never really planned that far ahead with the band. I mean, I think we'll certainly do another record, that's for sure. We've already written some ideas that I think will push us in a fresh direction for another album. So we're certainly going to do that. But for me, I just keep rolling with it, as long as it's creative and as long as it's challenging and fulfilling and doing what I want it to do, then we'll keep going. But yeah, I don't project too far forward and say we have to be doing this or we need to be here or there. For me, it's really just a tool for creativity and for expressing ideas that are, you know, really important in my life and that we find important as a collective. So as long as that hunger's there, as long as that fire's burning and we're still doing it justice, then we'll continue.
And if you ever reach the point where you decide that it's time to put Denouncement Pyre to rest, how do you want to be remembered?
It's a really difficult one, because I guess it's up to other people to determine how they would think of such a thing. If I had to choose something, I'd say as sincere would probably be the most generous compliment you could receive. So it's, you know, what we're doing is sincere. I hope people can see that.
So Forever Burning is the name of the fourth Denouncement Pyre album, and it's out now through Agonia Records. Paul, please tell people how they can order the album. What's the best way for them to get it?
So you can order it directly from the record label, Agonia Records. They have copies up on their Bandcamp page now. That's on vinyl, picture disc, CD, cassette, and of course digital. You can order it so direct from the label, from their Bandcamp, and there's also distributors that will have copies shortly. In Australia in particular, Direct Merch will be doing official distribution, and there'll be others for Europe, UK, and USA soon.
So by the time people hear this podcast, I'm not sure how many of the limited edition vinyl that Agonia created for this release will still be available. But do you want to say anything about them, about the picture disc and about the colored vinyl that they created?
Yeah, they did a bunch of different versions. There's, I think, black vinyl, red vinyl, a fire colored vinyl, and a picture disc. So in various amounts, but jump onto it, I guess, quickly, and that'll mean you've got more chance of getting one.
So you're talking about the sound of the vinyl and working with James to master this album for vinyl. What can you say about the sound and listening and the experience of listening to this album on vinyl?
I think comparing the digital master to the vinyl master, the vinyl's just a little bit more dynamic. It's to do with the amount of compression that goes onto the recording at mastering stage. But I think for the maximum listening experience, the vinyl's definitely the way to go. I'm still very pleased with how the digital version sounds and the CD version, but the vinyl version is just that little bit better.
And if people want to keep up to date with what Denouncement Pyre is doing, how can they follow you online?
We've got all the usual social media pages that people can jump onto, where there's news posted about upcoming shows and merch and, you know, release information. So check out the Denouncement Pyre Facebook and Instagram pages for more news and info.
And what do you guys have planned for the rest of the year?
We're actually playing a show in a couple of days in Sydney, which will be the first show we've done in over a couple of years. And then the week after, we've got a show in Melbourne that I mentioned earlier with Stalker from New Zealand. And then around 4 weeks after that, we've got a show again in Melbourne supporting Psychroptic on their album launch show. So that'll be quite a big one here. So just the three gigs planned at the moment to help launch the new album. And then we'll look at some other things later in the year as well. In addition to that, we're always working on ideas. So still writing and being creative in terms of coming up with something new for the next record.
And do you want to give anybody a hint on what the next record might sound like?
It's quite hard to, because I don't know the answer to that myself yet. But at this early stage, I would say it won't sound exactly like the new album, Forever Burning. It'll be different again. I don't want to give too much away, but we'll steer it in a different direction, I think. To what degree, time will tell.
Excellent. Looking forward to it. Thank you, Paul.
Thank you. We'll be right back.
Will be watched the world.